Going back to the older generation, my father's generation, that was the generation that had to suffer and work very hard. It was through their hard work, their devotion, their sense of commitment to their own society and their own responsibilities that they were able to make of us what we are today. And I recall myself as a child that the changes that have taken place in Kuwait, whether physically or in attitudes, are so dramatic. Yet at the same time, without us letting go, shall we say, our traditions, or let go completely our own background. Nomadic community settled in a desert and evolved a new industry, a new trade, pearl diving, seafaring. This was a dramatic adjustment for nomadic tribes from the desert to become people very much involved with the sea.
Of realism, which we borrowed, I think, you know, from the toughness of the desert, the adventurism of the sea, the alertness of our harsh environment, and also the contact with foreign cultures. And where we anchored, we benefited. And definitely, we benefited from the cultural and the practical, never the political. The Kuwaiti songs and folkloric performances is African. This is either sea-oriented, African-imported, or Indian-inspired. You find this amalgamation of this Indian imprint, plus African imprint, plus also the dialogue or monologue with the sea, with the invisible, with the monstrous darkness of tomorrow.
Discovery of oil made it possible for Kuwait to make a second phase adjustment, if you like, to a much broader world, to the world at large. So the world of today is not the world of the 30s or the 40s. We emphasized right from the very beginning that our best investment should be in the individual. And if you look at the number of schools and the number of clinics and the number of hospitals that were built in Kuwait for over the last 30 years, and relate them to the number of office buildings that were built for ministers and for government offices, you'll find that there is a great disproportion between these two, and that the emphasis has been on the man, the creation of better men, rather than the creation of better physical infrastructure. An individual is really a raw diamond. It might have some value, but the greatest value it has is when it is polished. And education is the polishing process. It's not a structured society that is difficult to move in. This is a society which is built in the best Islamic tradition, where social mobility is a factor of the role of the individual in his society. So you can come from a very poor background. If you have the talent, you can go up in this society to become one of the most respected members of it. I believe that the best educational institutions around the world are for mankind at large. And I would very much like to see Kuwait University a host, as it is today, to students from many nationalities, and that we excel in certain areas where people come from other parts of the world to conduct their research there.
We didn't have any contact with Syria or with Egypt until the late 40s, when there was an urgent need for expansion in education. Now, we had only one school. Well, the first thing we resorted to was to bring teachers from Palestine, who came in the late 30s, and then the outflow of Egyptians in education. Why did we do that? The overriding fact is this is an Arab territory. Its culture is Arabic. Its breath is Arabic. It's not only the language, not only the religion. It's part and parcel of the Arab world. The dynamism of the Gulf, the survival of the Gulf, is Arabism, but not political Arabism. It's Arabism of the daily life. Culturally, we are dominated by powerful outflow of Cairo and Damascus and Amman and Beirut.
في الدول العربية اللي هي مثلا لسه نامية غير الشعب المصري يعني مثلا هنقول مثال السعودية هنقول مثال الكويت هنقول مثال الإمارات هنقول مثال الدول دي بالنسبة التعداد بتاعها ضعيف إنما إحنا تعدادنا كتير فعلشان كده هم عندهم بترول إحنا عندنا اليد العاملة الكتحة فإحنا نقدر نقول إن إحنا أحسن منهم أحسن منهم في إيه؟ في اليد العاملة إيه الفايدة؟ أنا معايا فلوس لكن مش قادر أعمل بيها حاجة بستعين بإخواتي العرب بستعين بولاد العرب علشان يعملوا بلدي
We are very, very proud of our parliamentary system. Kuwait got independence in 1961. Immediately following that, the Emir issued a decree for a general election to elect a constituent assembly to prepare the constitution for the state. The number of members are 50, elected freely by the electoral roll. One of the advantages we have in Kuwait is that the member is elected on his merit, not on his party's merit, which we don't have a party system in Kuwait. So the member has to work very, very hard in order to get elected. We also publish in the official gazette all the proceedings, where were forward, everywhere said in the assembly. It's published and it is sold in the bookshops and distributed to all ministries and everything. And the freedom not only extends to journalism, but also to the rights of individuals.
Our first problem as a woman in Arab world, you know, and Muslim countries, I think, is that we don't know our legal rights. And that's very dangerous, you know, because if you don't know your right, especially your legal right, I don't think you can know how to protect yourself. And this is the thing, because women are not been participating, in fact, in process of making law or enacting legislation. It was very difficult for me to be a lecturer in law, because I was the first one as a woman in law faculty and Sharia. Mm. And then to be a dean, I think it was too much for them, but it wasn't for me too much.
Okay, if it is a sterile, don't touch it, okay? Mm-hmm.
Most of the women in Kuwait are working, you know? They are doing very well. Now in Kuwait, I don't think there's any difficulty.
She had an evacuation under general anesthesia.
Although many Arab women, especially in the Gulf region, you know, have not been educated. For instance, my own mother, you know, she can't read and write, you know, she's illiterate completely. And my mother contributed a lot, in fact, in pushing me to go to school. As you know, many Arab family, you know, the mother, she's the one. You know, she's the one and the most important person in that society, although she doesn't go outside the house, but still she's the one to decide everything.
In Kuwait, you had only two daily newspapers. On 1961, it started. One of it was published, it was daily, but it was published twice per week, and it was printed in Beirut and brought to Kuwait by aeroplane. Then, on 1962, they had their own press, and they started to have a daily of 6 pages only. Who is my reader? Maybe if I were in Lebanon, or in London, or in Washington, I would speak in Washington to the Americans, in Lebanon to the Lebanese, in Cairo to the Egyptians. The hardest part of our work in Kuwait is our audience. That is, our audience is a foreign media. It's many groups. You have to speak to the Palestinians, to the Egyptians, to the Kuwaitis, to the Iraqis, to the Syrians. And also, at the same time, you have to keep that harmony in your paper amongst all of those people in. You know, Kuwait, the majority are non-Kuwaitis. It is not the money, it's not the fortune in Kuwait which made journalism. What made journalism progress in Kuwait is freedom in Kuwait. Because you can't have press without freedom. Okay, Habib. Tikram. Alhamdulillah, salam. Okay, Radal. So you see, it's not the money. Having the money in Kuwait, it helped a lot to create journalism and to reach to the stage to which it is now. But the most important factor in journalism is the freedom. This lack of freedom in other parts of the Arab world had led the journalists to come from Syria, Egypt, Palestinian groups, Lebanese in particular. It wasn't just searching for gold.
But what happens if you run out of money? What happens when you run out of oil? What happens if oil loses its importance? A lot of people say Kuwait or other oil-producing countries are very rich, and they are richer than developed countries. They are not. Because other countries, the industrial countries and developed countries, are rich because they are producing industrial goods, consumer goods, what have you. And to live off just one single resource that you get off the ground and you're going to lose it forever, once you get it out of the ground, you're going to lose it forever, is not an indication of productive, developed society. Any development process cannot succeed if you don't have an indigenous scientific capabilities. One knew already that oil was a major industry going to be in Kuwait, and surely one knew that any R&D institution established in Kuwait must play a strong role in the oil industry, but it was not limited when it was conceived. For example, when they started the institute, they did a lot of good work on the classification of desert plants that are naturally available in this environment. They did a lot of work on the fishes of Kuwait, studying them, classifying them, which was a very good database for the later work on fish culture and mariculture that the Institute is doing. What we're trying to do here is trying to, first of all, revitalize applied research and get the idea of research accepted by the society. For example, you want to harness solar energy for electricity generation. You have a specific objective in mind. It would be unrealistic to expect that we're going to make our own contribution independent of the scientific and technological capabilities that have been developed somewhere else. And it would be a shame to do that, because we would be losing so much. We would have to duplicate so much of the work that has already been done. But we feel that the natural process is to absorb the technology and adapt it to our needs. And slowly, slowly, we will start making our own contribution. This is the natural process. Arabic and Islamic civilization, we did exactly the same. Scientists from other civilization came and worked in the in Baghdad and Alexandria and Damascus, and they brought with them the scientific heritage from these other civilization. And after it was assimilated, then the new productivity of that civilization started taking place, and we're doing exactly the same. Thank you.
perfect now, Manuel. Absolutely in the middle. Very good. Yeah, if you could do, that would be nice. Don't touch it.
I think so.
Yeah, it will.
When we started collecting, my husband and I had no idea nor intention of putting it in a museum. But suddenly we realized that our house was too small to accommodate all these pieces that we've collected through the 8 years that we have been collecting. So we felt sad to put it in a warehouse or lock it in banks and things like that. So we thought of having our own museum. I think it's an act of selfishness to keep it for yourself and not to have others to enjoy it as much as you do. This is one of the main reasons why this collection is housed in this museum, is to introduce people to our lost heritage. I mean, we're trying to get these pieces closer to the place where they originally generated.
There are very, very few people who have any idea, and I mean Arabs, who have any idea what Arab or Islamic art is. And this museum is going to reveal something to them. It is not only to show them something to be proud of, but maybe something to understand. At the beginning, I was looking at them as objects that I had nothing to do with. I mean, absolutely nothing. All I got from them was shape, form, color, nothing else. And with time, I began to realize that these objects were used 400 years ago, or admired 600 years ago, or manufactured 800 years ago. So they began to give me another meaning. And I began to see them as objects used in a certain place, at a certain time. I was interested in astrolabes, initially as works of art. But in Islamic tradition, art and science were very closely linked. Many people bought this at the time, also as a work of art. This happens again and again in Islamic science. Very often, art is mixed with science very much, in manuscripts, in objects, in astrolabes. An astrolabe could have been made very simply to serve its purpose. But of all the astrolabes I know of from the medieval period, they are all artistically inclined.
I don't remember that any Arab has tried this. Only the government ran after such big project. It's something related to civilization. It is something which is not materialistic. Even the things in it are materialistic. Even $100 million or more were paid to make it. Okay. But this is something looking after the heritage. This is something related to civilization. For this is important. The Kuwaitis are very ambitious. They want to stress and to confirm their presence as a people. They want to tell everybody that they are different and distinctive.
Today, a Kuwaiti is a citizen of the world. It has given him a sense of responsibility towards a much broader region than that of Kuwait, something which came as an evolution of Kuwait becoming a more of an important economic center than ever before. We are the product and the victims, shall we say, of the developments in the world that took place since the Depression. The only difference is we had to telescope development and evolution in such a short time.
All the world is intertwined in this global structure through the World Bank and also through financial institutions and also through the outflow and inflow of trade. I believe that the key now for the Arab world is to establish an Arab consensus, the minimum of Arab understanding, the minimum of Arab solidarity, the elimination of tension, animosity among them. That's what bothers me. How can we preserve our culture, heritage, the Arabic heritage of the Gulf, and character, and also with all its shortcomings, with the need for this inflow of foreign labor, foreign muscles? I think if I have to choose between priorities and make a set of priorities, the overriding thing for me is Arab culture, Arab heritage, Arab personality of the Gulf, the characteristics of the Gulf, the Gulfness of the Gulf, the preservation of what we were, what we are, and what we look for.